Hi, my name is Stephen Haeg with MTS Systems Corporation. Today I'm going to spend some time talking to you about heavy truck durability testing in the laboratory. So how are we going to conserve power, reduce cost? Well, different components have different sensitivity to inertial loading. So the velocity of truck and trailer axles may not generate much damage as displacement does. The dampers and things can be tested at the component level. So that offers an option to reduce test velocity, possibly test frequency, to reduce the acceleration, reduce the force. Reducing acceleration means lower force. Reducing the velocity means lower velocity at the pistons is less oil flow demand. That sounds to me like a good way to be saving money. So that allows a corresponding reduction in test system power. It actually is kind of a squared system because when we reduce the force, we have smaller pistons. When we reduce the velocity, they move slower. That gives us a big savings on the overall power demand to operate this system. Let's take a look at some examples. Here's a time history on some rough road surfaces. Broken concrete and a washboard surface. 40 G's and 6 meters a second. Pretty severe surface, but this is real data. So the surface with the highest flow demand is this washboard surface. You can see how dense and high the velocities are on that continuously moving. We've got about 4,000 liters per minute peak flow is coming out of here, almost 5,000 liters a minute peak. The flow equals a piston area times piston velocity. So surfaces with high acceleration generate large inertial forces. Truck axles can weigh several tons. Fixtures and bearings between the actuator and specimen must be strong and rigid so they get heavy. So you got to have enough actuator force to accelerate all that stuff. Surfaces with sustained high velocity require large HPU. Sometimes we require high power, like hundreds of thousands of kilowatts. In fact, one system we installed was on the megawatt order. So if we look at the overall HPU demand, which equates directly to power into the building, typical rough road surface is about 1,000 liters per minute per axle, whereas the washboard surface is about 2,000 liters per minute per axle. That means I have to double the size of the pumps if I'm going to run that system real time. So how am I going to get a drive file with lower power but the same damage? Well, I've got multi-axial inputs. Phase and amplitude must be the same. It's a multi-axial environment. I've got to keep that phasing right to get my fatigue damage right. Some events occur very quickly, like a pothole or chuck hole or curb crossing, washboard road. Some events are very slow and take a long time. Brake events, turning corners, driving twist ditches, maneuvering around obstacles. So how can we get this damage content contained within our test and still reduce our power demand? One way to do that is with peak valley slicing. It retains the peak amplitudes, retains the phase relationship, and it can replicate real-time fatigue loading that occurs in a multi-axial system. It allows us to optimize test time versus power. We can edit the data based on oil flow, slow down high dynamic events, and speed up slow events to reduce test time. If the specimen is less sensitive to inertial and damper type loads, then we can reduce the acceleration and we can reduce the piston velocity. But we need to retain the displacement history. So how do we do that? Well, we take the desired displacement time history and we peak and valley slice every channel when it gets to a high spot or a low spot, a peak or a valley. We simultaneously sample all channels each time one channel gets to a peak or a valley, because then we've got a set of points, simultaneous playback points, where one channel is reaching an inflection point and the other channels are all going to be measured and in phase and in amplitude at the same time. Then we can put this back together at a desired velocity based on the oil flow that we want. In other words, we can change the slope of the connecting lines based on our oil flow demand. That allows us to reduce the overall expense of the system. Fewer pumps, smaller hydraulic distribution system, fewer accumulators, less overall maintenance, less power in the door. It's a commonly used method for testing frame and chassis, suspension and components, leaf springs and axles, for example. Here we show a multi-axial file with an example of peak valley slicing. The critical information is phase and amplitude at each peak or valley. So we slice all channels whenever any one channel reaches a peak or a valley. The resulting points can be reassembled, for example, at whatever desired velocity based on our oil flow capability. So this is an example of a time-stretched peak-valley example where we took a constant time expansion to take this very fast event and slow it down to reduce the oil flow demand. So unfortunately, when we time stretch everything uniformly, slow events also get stretched out, which is not advantageous because it stretches out our test time without improving our throughput. So instead, we play back with a constant rate. Here is what I'm connecting these dots together with, a constant velocity. Now we can compress our very slow event, play it back in very small time, and then we can expand our high dynamic event so that we don't have so much dynamics in it, but we still get all the same displacements. And so the result is the same fatigue damage played out with much lesser power requirement. Here's an example over here where we take a very slow event and we stretch it out, and you can see that we get the same amplitude, the same overall characteristic. Here we've got some small cycles on top we wanted to reproduce, so we stretched that event out so we'd get clear definition of the small cycles as well. And then this big cycle over here that's slower, you can actually see that it got compressed. This is an example where we've got break events, 40 seconds of break events in a row. Well, there's a whole lot of doing the same thing in each of these events that really doesn't increase the damage. So we can shorten these up, again, connect the peak valleys with the constant velocity, and reduce this event to a 10-second playback. That's a 4-to-1 time savings. In this case, we've got a pothole strike. This is a third of a second, 0.3 seconds for the entire event. Very high velocity, very high acceleration, very high oil flow demand. By stretching that third of a second event out to 2 seconds, about 1/7 as fast, we can play it back at a very low velocity, much less oil flow is required, and all the displacements and forces are still achieved. The advantages is we produce proper vector loading on the components. We get to slow down some events otherwise that would otherwise require high performance. We can able to speed up slower events to accelerate our test time. The disadvantages are frequency-related effects are not included. If you're looking for some free response characteristic here, you're really not going to get it. This is all forced response. May not reproduce proper loading at rate-sensitive materials. We've got elastomers, some components, maybe adhesive joints, which are not so common in truck components. We may be concerned about changing the velocity of the data. If we look at this example of a displacement time history stretched out, here's our original data played in real time. Let's 50% time expand it, just that section. Now if we take a look at our accelerations, they're down, this is our original acceleration was here, we're down to 25% of the acceleration by doubling the amount of time. Frequency squared is our acceleration sensitivity. Our velocity is down by 50% because velocity is directly proportional to frequency. So our original data required 2,000 liters a minute. Our 50% time expanded data only required 1,500 liters a minute of our HPU, and we could double the time by 100% expanding it, and then we go down to 1,000 liters a minute. So this all allows us to reduce our overall power here and see very clearly what effect it's going to have on our power demand. So axle tests can require up to 2,000 liters a minute of hydraulic power. That's 790 kilowatts of electric power and 1,000 liters a minute of cooling water, in addition to just running the pumps. Consider replacing the HTS capacity with accumulation if high flow demand is for short bursts. That might work for hitting a pothole, but it's not going to work for a washboard road where we're doing 20 to 40 seconds of continuous playback. We're not going to have enough accumulators to provide that oil. We need an HPU to provide it. Large force is large piston area, then large piston area times high velocity is high flow. So we reduce our required force and or velocity, we're going to come out ahead in the power spectrum. So the first thing we must do is understand specimen sensitivity before we can edit the data. We have to know that the test is going to still have the damage content to get the answers we need to answer our question. We need to reduce the acceleration and velocity by expanding the time base. Peak valley slicing is a good technique for that. And we can reduce the power demand by 50% or more and still retain basically all of the fatigue damage from the field. This is an example of a chassis test, a frame and chassis assembly test for a heavy vehicle that's done with peak valley time stretching. The fifth wheel is, this frame is inverted, and the fifth wheel is grounded to the base plate. And so you see here the tire patches are up in the air, and you see multi-axial loads are brought into each tire patch location. We've got engine mount forces are coming into the engine block here, and there's a couple of other loads on the system as well. Peak valley data is played back. We stretch it out so it's got a content of about 2 to 3 hertz to get our oil flow demand down. And we can do real-time playback. Requires about 6,000 liters a minute to run this three-axle test. We can do this whole thing at 2 hertz, requires only 1,000 liters a minute, 1/6 of the test for power. Full life test takes 3 weeks. Very repeatable. We can do a lot of studying with these kind of tests. This is an example of a similar test run with a similar method. In this case, it was not inverted. The fifth wheel was bolted to a cross member on a portal frame. Vertical actuators were brought in from above, and then the longitudinal and lateral actuators were brought into the axle itself. And in that case, we've got not only engine torques and loads, but we've also got cabin mounting loads, and you could put fuel tanks and other loads into the test if you wanted to do a more accurate simulation. We're also working on a new road simulator, the real-time heavy truck system that mounts on top of a flat plate. We're going to have an adaptation whereby we can do an upright specimen or an inverted specimen, such as you see here. So the same systems can be used for both type of tests. Here we've got an upright specimen. It could be a fixed axle. It could be a full vehicle. And here we've got our inverted chassis test, where we've got our tire patches in the air and our system is grounded to the floor. So however you might want to configure a test like this, these kind of fixtures are very universal for developing not only truck axles and suspension systems, but also chassis and frame systems.